Mr. Velocity. He is risen. Let's stand up and we're going to sing together.
And then you came in love.
be a weapon.
Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy.
Praise.
Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise.
We sing your name.
We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything.
To me, and when I said Happy Easter, they responded back with, He is risen. I don't know if you believe that this morning, but we don't serve a Jesus that just got to the end of his life, died for our sin, and stayed dead. I serve a Jesus that after 3 days, after being in a tomb, proved that he was either crazy or Christ. And on the third day, he had the opportunity to show back up and prove to everybody that he was exactly who he said he was. So we stand in here this morning celebrating an empty tomb. Celebrating. And I'm sorry to take one more second. But we watched The Passion of the Christ yesterday. And right there, there's Jesus and there's Barabbas. We're standing back here with the band back here, and they say, we can let one of these go. We can let this Jesus go. Come on, he's not a really bad guy. Or we can let Barabbas go. And they let Barabbas go, and Jesus goes on to take the punishment. I stand here today as Barabbas. You stand there today as Barabbas. As Jesus came and took our place for our sin and our shame, died a horrible death to raise again for the newness of life, and we get to walk in the likeness of Christ. So this is what this says. This says, this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. So if you know that we're celebrating an empty tomb this morning, I want to challenge you to sing like we've never done before. Come on.
This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like.
Come on.
This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like.
this morning on Easter Sunday, beautiful fourth day of April. You look amazing. Welcome to Velocity Church. So glad you're with us this morning. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad you're here. And I so hope that you felt welcome when you stepped into our parking lot and you've moved through our campus, through the Welcome Center, through the Breezeway, to the Worship Center. I so hope that you felt that welcome atmosphere, that welcome culture. That's one of our values here at Velocity Church. We want you to feel welcome. We'd love to connect with you. If this is your first time here, please, out to my left, your right, out to those double doors. Connect Central, my wife's out there today, Crystal, and we'd love for you to fill out a Connect card just so we can send you a thank you for being here over the week. And we'll also put you on a mailing list to get a little encouraging thought each month. And so we'd love to connect with you, give you a gift for just being here with us this morning, this beautiful Easter Sunday. Our mission here at Velocity Church, the reason without why we're even named this vehicle, this platform is named Velocity, is velocity. We have movement here. And you better believe we're moving in the right direction. And that's our mission, to point people in the right direction. That's Jesus Christ, to fulfill the Great Commission. That's our mission. That's why we're named Velocity. And we do so through our values of making one another feel welcomed, by loving one another, by encouraging one another along life's journey, by forgiving one another, and by helping restore one another. That's our values. And so we have this vehicle called Velocity Church, and we're able to move throughout this community and move throughout this state and throughout the world, for that matter, to share the love of Jesus. So I'm so glad you're with us this morning to celebrate Easter Sunday. Our text announcements, we've been putting most of our announcements on text. And so if you'd like to get our next announcements throughout the week, feel free to text Velocity SC to 864-375-6335, and you'll get all those announcements throughout the week. We have a lot of them because we have a lot of moving parts, because we want to make a difference, and we seek to make the difference in the people's lives to show that Jesus is real. And so if you'd like to get our announcements, just text that Velocity FC to that number, and you'll get our announcements throughout the week. I'm going to pray for us before we open up our Derailed series. This is round one of the Derailed series. I'm going to pray for us. We're going to continue to worship, and we're just going to enjoy a time together. Brothers and sisters in Christ, Christ followers, coming together to praise the King of all kings. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for these moments that you've allowed us to gather together to worship you, Almighty God. And so, Lord, we come right now and we thank you. We thank you this Easter Sunday, Lord. We thank you for your suffering, how you suffered for us, how you suffered for us at your trial, how you suffered for us at your scourging, how you suffered for us on the road to the cross. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for how you suffered and died on the cross so that we may live. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for how you conquered death, that we may have and accept eternal life. So Lord, we thank you. And Lord, we lay these moments at your feet right now and pray that everything that's said and done in these moments would glorify you, Almighty God. And we'll be very careful to give you the honor and the praise and the glory for these moments in your wonderful name. Amen. Thank you.
Let's stand and sing. This verse says, our Father, everlasting, the all-creative, God Almighty. chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Could imagine so great a mercy? Who heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken. Forgiven, the King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free.
No claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim.
your resurrection. Jesus, we give you all the glory and all the honor. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said amen. You guys can have a seat.
Walking down the Saluda Grade in Saluda, North Carolina. The Saluda Grade is, even to date, America's steepest grade of a railway. And it launched July 4th, 1878. First passenger train traveled on this railroad. You can imagine during America's third ever Independence Day celebration that they had, that all the job opportunities, all the economic impact opportunities, all the people, and inevitably a community that it would launch and support. Over 100 years, this railroad stayed in operation, and there's not a lot of news about what caused its inevitable, what we stand in now, this ruin. Something that had an incredible rise, something that had a ton of momentum, and something causing its inevitable stop. You could look at something that would last 100 years and say, man, what a success story. But in all reality, it lasted only half of the life that it was expected to live.
So today we're looking at Genesis chapter 27, the genealogy of Terah. And many times we look at the genealogy and we get bored with it. We think there's not a whole lot in it. But today we're going to dig. We're going to dig a little bit and take a look, go a little bit further. And there's some promises. There's some things that God gives us in His Word always. It's never void. So let's take a look. Genesis 27. It says, this is the count of Terah. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. You need to listen and remember Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldeans in the land of his birth. In the land of his birth. So we're going to skip on down just a little bit. We're going to go to verse 31. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, which was the son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarah, the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. And then in verse 32, it says that Terah lived 205 years, and he died in Haran. So let's unpack that out of Genesis. Terah wants to take his family out of Sin City, Ur of the Chaldeans. That's a place that's doing moon worship. And they want to go to the promised land, the land of Canaan. And so on the way, they end up stopping at a halfway point called Haran. Haran, that's a huge deal because his son that died, Terah's son that died, his name's Haran. So can you imagine the sorrow? Can you imagine the grief that Terah must have felt when they get to this place, Haran? Like, oh my goodness. And so he settles there. Whether it's from complacency, whether it's from sorrow, whatever's going on, they never arrive at their final destination of going to Canaan, the promised land. They never arrived there. They settled. They stopped. Life was in ruins for them, never going to the final destination. And you know what? Terah lived to be 205 years old because he had stopped and he had said.
So Terah, what happened to Terah? Terah settled. Terah was derailed. For whatever reason, Terah just decided, we're not going to go all the way. You know, maybe he was grieved about his son. It's called Haran. It was the halfway point. And Terah, he was headed to the promised land, but he didn't make it. Did you hear that? He lived for 205 years. That jugger lived a long time. But probably about 100 of those years, he settled. He camped out. He was derailed. He didn't go any further. And I would think There's some people in here today. Maybe there's some people that are watching today. Maybe you're sort of feeling, maybe you felt like Terah at one time or another. Maybe you were headed full steam going, and then something happened. You had a hardship, or you had a crisis, or things didn't go like you thought they were going to go, and then you got derailed. Your train went off the tracks. You're like, how am I going to make it? And then somebody came, and you got some help, and things got better. Then you got back on the tracks. Then your train got going again. I think there's a lot of you in here like that. Your train got going, full steam ahead. You know where your destination's at. You can't wait to get there, but while you're here, you're living faithful and you're doing what God's called you to do. That's a great place to be, isn't it? I think there's a lot of people in here like that today. I think there's also a lot of people watching today that you've saying, Reggie, I feel just like Terah did. I've been derailed. I'm off the tracks right now. And it's really rough. I've had a crisis, or you've had a hardship, or things have gotten bad. And for some reason or other, you're trying to figure out life right now. In fact, in train terminology, it's called a bad order. A bad order. That's a train car needs repair. It's called a bad order. Maybe you're feeling like a bad order today. You're like, Reggie, I'm derailed. I need to get to the freight yard. That's where it goes, gets repaired at. I need to get to the freight yard. Some of you feeling that right now. If I could just get to the freight yard, I'd be okay. Things would be better. And today you're hoping that there's going to be some encouragement that's going to come your way. That there's going to be something that's going to help you get back on the tracks, that you're going to not be derailed anymore, that you're going to figure out life's purpose, you're going to figure out how to get to your final destination, you're going to figure out how to go full steam ahead, blazing the trail full of smoke, and you realize, man, you're going to realize what you're here on earth for. There's purpose. There's hope. You're hoping. Some of you are saying, well, Reggie, how do I get off from being derailed and how to get back on the tracks? Well, if you're asking that today, I just want you to know I'm really glad that you're asking that question, because I'm going to tell you about the one who came so that you and I could have life, so that we could have life better than we could ever imagine before. We could stop being derailed. Instead of being lonely, instead of being anxious, instead of being derailed, and I want you to fill in the blank, whatever crisis, whatever hardship you've hit, you can fill the blank in on that one. I want you to understand that Jesus came for every one of us. Whether you're derailed now, or you're back on the tracks, wherever you're at in life, Jesus came for every one of us. He came so that we could have life and we could have it abundant. In fact, in John 10:10, he came that we could live life to the fullest. Ask yourself right now, am I living life to the fullest? Or do I feel like I'm off the tracks? Or am I trying to figure out I've had some kind of crisis, something go on? In John 10:10, it says the thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you could have life and that you could have it to the full. Man, that's good news right there, isn't it? You could have life and have it abundantly. Well, what does abundant life look like, Reg? How about this? What if you could have more joy? Think about that. What if you could have more peace? What if you could find out the purpose that you're created for? We're going to talk about that. Some of you may be thinking, that joy sounds pretty good. I looked up the definition for joy, and it means great pleasure. What if we could live life with great pleasure? It actually says independent of circumstances. But I started thinking about joy, and I thought, what if we could live with joy above our circumstances? See, many of you are derailed right now. Or many of you are trying to figure out some kind of situation. But what if we could live above those circumstances with the joy, with that life that God gives to every one of us? That'd be a great place to live, wouldn't it? Then I thought about that abundant life. That abundant life that God gives is also this thing called acceptance. I believe this world is looking for somebody who will accept them. I believe this world is looking for somebody who will actually care. I mean, not just say it, but really care. Who would accept them? In John chapter 6, 37, it says, all those the Father gives me will come to me. All those the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I love this right here. I want you to take this, personalize this. And whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. That's a great God, isn't it? Woo! So you mean I can come to God and he'll never drive me away? That's exactly right. He'll accept you as you are. Now here's what I'll tell you. God loves you too much for you to stay the same, because he's going to help you get back on the tracks. He's going to help you stop being derailed. And if you're on the tracks and you're running and you're trying to figure out, man, I just want to know God to love me. Yeah, he says, I'll never drive you away. I'll take care of you. I'll give you what you need. I'll put you in the direction you need to go on. He'll give us that joy. He'll give us that peace. He'll give us that purpose. What a great place to be. You need to know this. God has been pursuing you from the day you were born. That's how much he loves you. I want you to personalize this message this morning. This is for you. It's not just for the person beside you. It's for you. It's for everybody watching and listening to the sound of my voice today. I want you to personalize what I'm telling you today. It says, in this, the love of God has made clear to us that God has sent his unique son into the world that we might live through him. Did you know Jesus came so that you could have true love? I know there's a lot of relationships that have gone wrong. You ever seen that happen? Maybe you've been through one of those relationships and you're trying to figure out, man, it's just crazy. Or I thought they loved me and they really didn't love me. Well, Jesus came that you could have true love. Jesus came that you could really understand what true love is all about. It says in 1 John 4, for God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. Eternal life. Because every one of us, we're going to live eternally. Some people think you're just going to die and go in the grave. Doesn't work that way. Your spirit's going to go on to live eternally. You're either going to be able to live in heaven or you're going to be able to live in hell. And God came so that you could, he loved you and he still loves you and he wants what's best for you so that you and I could have life. And it says, this is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and he sent his son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. See, God loved us first. God loved us in our sin. God loved us when we missed the mark. God loved us when we mess up. God loves us all the time. God still is pursuing every one of us because he wants what's best for you. Isn't that amazing? And I'll even let you get this. God chooses you. He chooses you. You just got to receive him. He chooses every one of us. Now, how about this? If I said Jesus came to give you purpose, we've talked about purpose a little bit today. If Jesus came to give you purpose, you say, Reggie, it'd be awesome if I knew where I was going. It'd be awesome if I knew what I was created for. Well, God says you were created in his image. And he says in Jeremiah 29, verse 11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Man, that's encouraging. Plans for good, not for evil. God's always about good. He's always about light. He's always about life. Plans for good, not for evil. To give you a future and a hope. If you look around the world today, would you say the world needs hope? Absolutely, doesn't it? And I believe there's many in here today, and I believe there's many watching today that you're saying, man, I need that hope. Well, Jesus says right here, God says in his word, to give you a future and a hope, to give you life, to give you purpose, to give you acceptance, to give you joy, to give you peace. So my question is, why in the world would you not want what Jesus offers? You ever thought about that? Why in the world would people not want what Jesus offers? What an amazing God. I'm so glad that you asked that question. Why would we not want what Jesus offers? Well, today we celebrate Easter. Today we celebrate Easter. You say, Reggie, why? What does that mean for us? What can that mean for us? Today, for many of you, you can think this. That means a brand new beginning. You can leave out of here with a brand new beginning today. You can get from being derailed, you can get back on the tracks, and you can find that purpose. And you may be thinking, well, Reggie, there's so many people that's against me. I feel beaten up. There's so many people that are against me, and it's just been a rough road. Did you know Jesus? There were a lot of people that were against him. He had a lot of people that was angry with him. Why were they angry with him? Because he said, and he was, and he is the Son of God. They got angry at him for saying that. They got angry because they thought that Jesus came to take their power away. And it was actually the religious leaders that thought he was going to take their power away. And you know what? They hated him and they were so angry with him that they decided they wanted to kill him. So Jesus has been to a place where it was pretty tough. And the thing is, Jesus knew what he was here for. His whole purpose was coming. His whole purpose for coming here to earth was to fulfill his mission, to stay on mission, to take your punishment and mine. for the sins that you and I have committed, the things we've done wrong, because there's not anybody in here that's listening. There's not anybody that's listening to the sound of my voice that has not done wrong. He came here for you and for me. So he knew, and he said, I don't want to get derailed. I don't want to get derailed because I need to stay on mission. And so what did he do? He went to this place called the Garden of Gethsemane. The Garden of Gethsemane. It says, then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be grieved, and he began to be distressed. And then he said to them, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Why was that? Because he knew what was about to take place. He knew what he was going to have to go through. He knew the torturous death of crucifixion that he was going to have to endure for you and for me. Think about that. And he went to this garden so that he could talk to God the Father. He's God the Son. He's talking to God the Father. He wanted to make sure he had the strength. He wanted to make sure he's staying on mission. He even said, Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. He knew it was going to be tough. Now, here's the thing. When I went to Israel, I got to go to the Garden of Gethsemane, and I saw it. The only thing I could continue to come on my mind was, when Jesus was in that garden, he had me on his mind. When Jesus was in the garden, I want you to make this personal for you. He had you on his mind. Whew. You're talking about something that's amazing. The King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the Creator of the world, had you on his mind when he went to the garden because he didn't want to be derailed. He wanted to stay on mission. He wanted to stay on purpose because he knew what was about to come. He knew it was going to get really bad. In fact, the Bible says he was grieved, and he was grieved so bad that he started sweating drops of blood. Now, I don't know about you, but I've never met anybody that sweated drops of blood. Jesus stayed on track. He didn't get derailed. Jesus kept with mission. And so we can look at Christ's perfect example and realize he didn't get off the tracks. So he was betrayed. Shortly after, he was betrayed. When he was betrayed by one of his disciples. I'm talking about somebody that followed him, somebody that had seen the miracles, somebody had seen the teaching, somebody had seen Jesus and knew who he was. But he was betrayed by one of those closest around him. That's pretty crazy, isn't it? So maybe you're feeling betrayed this morning. Maybe you're in a situation, you're like, man, it's just tough because I feel betrayed. Well, you need to know Jesus. He didn't get off the tracks, even though he was betrayed. So typically, the next thing was a crucifixion. But before the crucifixion, they typically did a whipping. They would beat the person. The Bible says that Jesus was beat so bad that he was unrecognizable. And here's somebody who hadn't done anything wrong. You ever thought about that? He had never done anything wrong. Nothing. Spotless Lamb of God is what the Bible says. So he took a beating. Many times they would give him a beating before the crucifixion, hoping they would die then. So they would beat them, and on this particular time, he was beat 39 times. You say, well, Reggie, that doesn't sound too bad. Well, let me tell you what the beating involved. It involved this thing called a cat of nine tails. A cat of nine tails was made specifically, and it had rocks in it, it had glass in it, it had iron in it. So it was specifically made so when they put the whip to the person, it came across their chest, and it would rip in and tear the flesh. Now, I don't know about you, but one time of that, I wouldn't want one rip because you didn't know where it was going to land. But they said, evidently, the people were so good, they could make it land where they wanted. So if it was in the chest, it hit the chest and it ripped. If it was in the neck, it hit the neck and it ripped flesh. If it was in the face, it hit the face and it come across their face. That's why it says Jesus was unrecognizable, somebody who had never done anything wrong. But he lived on mission and he stayed on purpose because he had you on his mind. Now, I want you to think about 39 lashes. Many times they said they could whip as long as they wanted, but on this particular one, and think about it, when they whipped them, they actually were hoping they would rip so much that many times they would rip their guts out and they would die there instead of going to the cross. See, Reggie, why do you have to say that? Because I want you to realize how much Jesus loves you. After that, then he was to be crucified. He was to be crucified, so what do they do? Many of you heard it. He had a wooden cross. He had to carry the cross against his raw fleshly skin. He didn't make it all the way carrying the cross. They got somebody else to carry the cross. They got to the point, Golgotha, where he was going to be crucified. And then what did? They took the spikes, and it went down into his hands. He's already been beaten where he can't be recognizable. He's already been whipped, man. You're talking about pain. You're talking about flesh. He has the nails and the spikes put in his hands. He has it put in his feet while he's on the ground. And then when they raise him up, I want you to think about the torture that it was when the flesh, the physical flesh, and the pounding into the ground. What that must have felt like when they raised him up. You see, Jesus stayed on track. Jesus stayed on mission. He wasn't derailed. Now, here's the thing about God. While all this was happening, of course, they'd already made fun of him. They'd already called him the King of the Jews. They had already put a crown of thorns on his head because he called himself the King of the Jews. And then they'd made fun of him and then mocked him. And I want you to think about how he must have felt up there on the cross. I want you to think about what he went through. And he could have called trillions of angels. Trillions. He could have called whatever he wanted. All Jesus had to do was breathe. All he had to do was breathe, and every one of them would have went, they'd have all died. But you see, even while he's on the cross, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's an amazing God, isn't it? That's an amazing love. That's an amazing mission, that he was on mission with you in mind. 2,000 years ago, he was thinking of you today. See, Reggie, how do I get back on track? What do I do? I want you to think about this. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, it says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. And I love this verse because it says, for the joy, look at that, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. He scorned its shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So, for the joy set before him. What was that? Does anybody know? The joy set before him was you. That's why he endured the cross. It comes again in Hebrews 12. For the joy, you're the joy that is set before God. And he's willing to do whatever. He was willing to do whatever. He was willing to take whatever beating, whatever whipping, whatever torture, because he was willing to be the sacrifice, the spotless Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world so that you and I could have life and have it abundantly. That's an amazing God, isn't it? So he was crucified. It actually says everything turned dark while he was on the cross. Afterward, there was an earthquake that happened. If you want to go read some more, I encourage you to go today. Read it with your family. Go look at the crucifixion story. And look at all the details that happened and the things that happened. Men, can you imagine what they were thinking when they realized, what have we just done? We have crucified the Son of the living God. It says after he was crucified, Mark 15 says, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God. He went boldly to Pilate and he asked for Jesus' body. So Joseph bought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in the linen, and he placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Now listen to this. Then it says, then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. He rolled a stone. So some people thought, even the disciples thought, and many people thought, well, he's dead. He's done. There's nothing else coming. I guess we just got to go back to our old lives. What are we going to do? But then it says in Mark 16, very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb. And as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. They were afraid. You know what's really cool? Is that young man sitting in a white robe, that's an angel. And he's saying, don't be afraid. You don't have to be afraid. He said, you're looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. And how about these words right here? He is risen. He is not here. There's an empty grave. There's an empty tomb. And because of that, you and I can celebrate Easter today because of the resurrection of Jesus. He didn't stay in the grave. He rose from the dead. That's why we celebrate Easter today. Give God praise today. Thank you, Jesus. So here's what the Bible says Jesus did for you and for me. It says in Isaiah 53, verse 5 and 6, but he was pierced for our transgressions. Make that personal, our sins, everybody's sin. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds, we are healed. You can be healed today. You can be back on the tracks. You can be all about what God wants you to be. It says, we all like sheep, we've gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. What an amazing God. He loved you first. He loved you when you didn't even know who he was. And some of you don't know who he is right now, but you're going to have a chance this morning that you can receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, and you can get on, you can stop being derailed. And many of you who've been on the tracks, and maybe you've just for some reason or another, you haven't been living on purpose, you can do that as well. You can say, God, I want to rededicate my life. I want to do the things you've called me to do. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for giving me life. Thank you that you're God. So because of what Jesus did, because of the resurrection, Christ conquered death. Because of Easter, we can have hope, we can have joy, we can have life, we can have peace because of what Jesus did for you and for me. Now, I want you to listen to this. There's this verse many of you have heard, many of you have seen. It's John 3:16. I'm going to go a little bit further from John 3:16 and 17 and 18, and I want you to listen to all the verses because in just a minute, I'm going to give you a time that you can reflect on what God's done for you. I'm going to give you a time to reflect, but I want you to listen to God's word. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. My question is, who on earth wouldn't want eternal life with a God that loves you that much? For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. See, a lot of people think, a lot of people got it wrong because Satan has lied a lot, and he said that Jesus came to condemn. No, Jesus didn't come to condemn the world. He came to save the world. He came to save us from our sins. He came to give us all the things we've talked about before. He came us to save the world through him. It says, whoever believes in him is not condemned. But whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. John 3:16 through 18. Now the question I have for you today is, what are you going to do with Jesus? Don't go out of here and say, I didn't hear anything, because you've been listening to me. The question is, what are you going to do with Jesus? I will tell you from personal experience, he's the best thing going. There's nothing better than Jesus. He'll heal your hurts. He'll take care of your addictions. He'll help you in the crisis. He'll help you in the hardships. He'll give you whatever you need. He'll give you life, and he'll give it abundantly. So what are you going to do with Jesus? You're going to listen to a song. I'm going to ask you to listen to a song as you reflect. What are you going to do with Jesus? Here's what I know about Jesus. Jesus stands at the door of your heart, and he's knocking. The thing about Jesus is he's a gentleman. He's not going to force his way in your life. But he stands at the door of your heart and knocks, and only you can open that door. Only you can open the door and allow Jesus to come inside. Let's pray and think about what Jesus has done for you. Father, we just want to say thank you that you're with us today. Thank you that you're here right now. Thank you that you know exactly where we're at. You know the hardships. You know the crisis. You know the times in our lives when maybe we just need to get back on track, or maybe we just need to take that next step of just realizing how much you love us so that we can live our lives with the purpose you want us to. Maybe there's some folks in here that's been Christians for a long time. But today you're realizing how much God really loves you, and it's time to get on the tracks and stop being derailed. For whatever reason, Father, we just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you that you love us. Thank you for caring about us. Thank you for dying on the cross for us. And thank you for the resurrection. Thank you for Easter as we continue to think on you. In Jesus' name.
Set free my
my God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. My sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Jesus paid it all.
Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. My sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought.
My sin
not in part, but the whole
is nailed.
Is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh, my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh, my soul.
That line says, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. The songwriter stops for a second, catches himself, and even repeats his statement. My sin, comma, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, not some of my sin, not just the public stuff, not just the stuff that people see, but the deep down stuff, the stuff that nobody sees. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I'm going to ask us to stand here in a second. Some of you are already standing. I'm going to ask you to stand. And for some of you came here today, and you feel the Spirit of God drawing you, pulling you. And He's saying, let's get back on the tracks. Let's get back on the life that I made for you. This life with Me, this life of peace, this life with grace, this life of mercy. Get back on this track that sin threw you off of. So I'm going to count to three, and on three, I want everybody to stand up. On three, I want everybody to stand up. But if you today say, I want to follow Jesus, I got to give my life to Him, in that moment of standing up, I don't even want you to stop. I just want you to end the motion, just walk down here. Pastor Reggie's going to be down here. Pastor Tim's going to be down here. We've got some people that want to pray with you. And when we stand, we're going to sing. We're going to finish this service out praising God for this empty tomb, this resurrected Jesus. And on three, one, On three, everybody's going to stand up. But if that's you today, God's calling you, just in that same motion, just come down. Two, three, let's stand up. Tomb mentality, that the same Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. Happy Easter. You guys have an incredible holiday. See you guys next week.